Tandor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Good Game by Anton Tekshin. Translated by Jennifer E. Sunseri. Narrated by Adam Verner. Preface. Grunting heavily, I chucked the last package into the murky waters of the reeking river. Hope I never had another weekend like this one. What sucked is that any stubborn investigator with a detector could still find these guys. What with today's technology, it was harder and harder to bury evidence. You had to be lucky to get away with anything. And yeah, we all know how fickle luck is. My lower back suddenly knotted up. It felt like a red-hot knitting needle was stuck in my spine, and somebody had grabbed it and was spinning it around. That combat stimulant was finally wearing off, leaving me with a nasty chemical hangover. On top of all else, I was freezing from the gusty cold rain. I felt like soaking in a hot, soapy bathtub for half an hour or so, and then heading straight to bed for the remainder of the night. Sadly, morning was just around the corner, and we weren't done yet. Looking around to ensure we were alone, I hurled a bag with bloody tools over the parapet such that it would fall into the main flow of the river. Whew, the last one. I had a good reason for this Herculean labor. If you can't hide something forever, then dispose of it in such a way as to not incriminate you. It's a tried and true approach to getting away with dirty deeds. Over my career hunting down the lowest of the low, I had to outdo them in cunning deviousness. I also had to be a meticulous sleuth, spending days and nights sorting through evidence to determine what was real and what was fake. Over and over again, what I learned from this were skills that I, in turn, applied to my own kills. For example, that murderous thug, whose fit of sneezing sent him tumbling into his nefarious sawmill, and then there's the one who, it seems, accidentally poisoned himself with his own potions, and that loser who'd been impaled by an icicle that, dropped at just the wrong moment. Karma works. But sometimes it needs a helping hand. Anyway, I would be long gone before anyone suspected me. And if not for that perverse puppeteer and Julia Rasokina, I'd have eluded detection another half year or so. Julia was the Ellie's little sister. Speaking of Ellie, she now broke into my musings. Though a sociopath in her own right, she too was the victim of a horrific past and a hard lot. If not for an old friend of her father, her cold-hearted mother would have shipped her off to one psychiatric hospital after another. Worse still, she'd have found herself at the bottom of the river, parceled out in several packages. "Someone's coming," whispered Ellie, tugging on my sleeve. "Okay." I limped away from the canal leading to the river, leaning on her narrow shoulder. Unfortunately, I'd had to get rid of my lethal cane, and it wasn't likely I'd find an adequate substitute for it any time soon. That alone pissed me off enough to want to pick up the bloody hacksaw and go at carving up someone else yet again. There was nothing to see until we reached the lane that led to the gates of the abandoned hangar. It took us at least 5 minutes to make our way to the car parked nearby, with headlights out and fake plates. We couldn't, of course, use a regular taxi, so we'd had to turn to Baba Nura yet again. But she was more than happy to help. A wizened woman with a steely character, she'd listen to our story and agree to assist us given our difficulties. Of course, for a price. Her compensation for her efforts was the nice car used by the would-be killers, as well as the documents and keys we'd found during our search of the vehicle. The Trinity used it most of the time, as the roomy SUV was reserved for business. It was an expensive ride, and so Baba Nira was getting a good deal, one which satisfied us as well. A young, curly-headed driver sat behind the wheel of the singularly inconspicuous car. He asked us to take a seat in back. The back seats, you see, were lined with special screens that blocked anyone sitting there from scanning devices. That's hardcore cyberpunk, for reals. You can even drive around downtown totally anonymously. And the same shield against detection was in the Trinity's SUV. It was an essential device for criminals anymore. We all had chips that, unfortunately, were used to track our movements wherever we went. but the surveillance network still lacked the satellites to carry out universal spying. There were blind spots even in the city, such as this hangar on the edge of an industrial zone. Here, nobody was watching. We'd driven off the highway and disappeared. So yeah, Big Brother wasn't watching us this time. We used this flaw in the network to create an image of a crime about to happen. The impending malfeasance would appear as follows to the less-than-diligent investigator. Alexandra Koganovich, formerly Rasokina, conspires to hire three thugs from the neighboring region to eliminate her minor child from a previous marriage. Elvira Rasokina. Her motive is to gain possession, pending her daughter's disappearance, of said offspring's real estate and other holdings. Koganovich estimates her daughter's worth at 7 million rubles. And provides the murderers for hire an advance payment of 10% of that amount. Appendix number 1, printout of bank transfer. The suspected killers, however, upon learning that the would-be victim resides in a guarded house in an elite district, demand more money, and actually blackmail Koganovich. Fearing exposure, she agrees to their demands, transferring funds to their account with an understanding that more will be provided once the deed is done. But a quarrel breaks out between Koganovich and the hired thugs, provoking them to turn against her. They force her into the car and drive her to the designated scene of the crime. Appendix number 2, blueprint of hangar. They force her to provide them with the password to her bank account, and then they transfer all of the remaining funds out and kill her instead of her daughter. They then cut her up into pieces, which they then package up and dispose of in the river. Appendix number 3, diver's report. The huge influx of cash in one short night sows discord between the killers. A fight ensues, wherein one employs a sword disguised as a cane, a devious weapon, though not as effective as a gun. With it he slays the other two, but not before one of the victims, on the verge of death, manages to shoot him with a deadly tranquilizer from a pneumatic pistol. Appendix number 4, forensic medical report. What causes the fire? It appears that the killer wielding the cane sword douses the car, used to transport Koganovich in gasoline, in an attempt to destroy the evidence. But now, woozy due to the tranquilizer, he collapses in the process of setting the gasoline on fire. Appendix number 5, arson report. The end. In the end, it's an almost comical situation worthy of Benny Hill, except for the seriousness of the matter. Journalists of all stripes love bloodbaths like this, unlike the authorities. So this matter would be wrapped up quickly, as long as the investigation wasn't negatively impacted. Perhaps someone or the other might take issue, but if so, he'd be shut down by irrefutable facts, such as why any outside killer would forego the opportunity to transfer the illicit funds to a shadow account. We're talking about millions. This would be a simple matter for any criminal with a communicator and a programmer on board. Without evidence from the scene of the crime, transfers such as that would be hard to track, even by experts. Incidentally, a communicator is listed in the evidence file, although it has been damaged in the fire. I completely forgot about it. As soon as we pulled onto the highway, Ellie, now an orphan, clung tightly to me. She, so unfazed by blood and gore, was now violently trembling. Well, who could blame her? A lot of horrors fell on her fragile psyche today.
Thank you.
And she gave me a light, awkward kiss on the cheek. Well, have you had enough?
Forgive me. Please.
Don't worry, kiddo. I'm no stranger to this kind of thing, I said with a crooked smile. Indeed, I felt a stab of pain deep inside. You did great. I couldn't have done it without you.
That's not what I meant. Ellie pulled back a little. I'm sorry I didn't believe in you. I was crushed, but you...
Just don't tell me you're going to run around the city again slaughtering perverts on my behalf. Not unless you want me to drop you off right here.
No, of course not. I'm not going to do anything stupid. I'll do whatever you say. If you want, I'll stay in the capsule 24/7.
I don't think so. Who'd take care of things at the apartment?
Well, I guess I could straighten up around there, she sighed. Now you're scaring me, I said. Give me back the old stubborn, sarcastic Elvira. I'm fine. It's just that I owe every breath I take from now on, good or bad, to you, she blurted out. I could have died. The sun would rise without me. Don't you get that? Don't twist yourself in knots over it. Just keep on keeping on. I can't. You have to try, I said. Think of it as what I want in return. Okay, she said, snuggling up closer to me. I'll do my best. And she gradually stopped trembling. I looked at the virtual clock over the dashboard and let out a curse. We were running late. We were due back on Your Grandmother, because in just 20 minutes, we were slated to enter the Talvro 19 system. And maybe the crew could make do without the unlucky little blade master, but without the boss man on board, it would turn into an uncontrollable herd with everyone acting on their own impulse. And that's not even taking into account the rather modest but nice upgrades made to the starship. Dude, can you speed things up? I asked the driver. He was doing the driving without auto assistance, so as to avoid straying into areas under heavy surveillance. Outside, we sped by slums and poorly lit residential areas. Some of them looked like they were ready to be demolished, even, as soon as the sun rose. Perhaps this was, in fact, the case. We'll be speeding along in just a minute, the driver assured us. We'll be blending in on the freeway like everybody else. This old car has a lot of power, don't worry. And sure enough, before long, we were on the corkscrew entrance to an overpass, which we accessed from what seemed like a back street. We briefly climbed upwards and exited onto a wide, smooth surface, lined by high, transparent shields embedded in concrete slabs. The car engine roared and flew along, pressing us against the seat backs. The lights of the city streamed in a blur outside the windows, and the road ahead narrowed as if we were traveling in a tunnel. Then the driver let autopilot take over and began to enter a report into the communicator. Say what you will, but Baba Nira ran a tight ship. We moved right along, and soon we were deposited not far from the park where it all started, right when night was falling. Thinking back on it, it wasn't easy luring 2031 Mother of the Year out, and I couldn't have done it without Ellie's help. First, I'd had to blackmail her with the help of one of the killers, and then set up a meeting with her. It helped having the killer as an intermediary, and I felt no pity for him. I also wasn't worried about him potentially leading the authorities to us. Even if the cops were to locate him, it's not likely they'd believe him, were he to insist he was incorrect in the matter of the late Alexandra Kaganovich Rasokina. How could he point the finger without incriminating himself? It's not like they would ask the real would-be victim, right? What a joke that would be. They could, of course, bring Ellie in for an interrogation. But why would they suspect her of anything? She was an angel, and so innocent. And she'd, been home all the time, sleeping. That's right, totally embedded in the game, with no idea of what was going on across the city, where a hangar was burning down, in which the killers of her mother were interned. And not only was she immersed in the virtual world, but so was the guy sharing her apartment. Ahem. That's right. We'd both been at home. Nobody had seen us out and about, not even housekeeping. Real people who'd resisted being replaced by robots. Nor the security personnel at the building. Ellie, after all, had passed the age of consent long ago and could live with whomever she wanted, even a grown man. Move along, folks. Nothing criminal here. Uh-huh, that's right. But then again, there's always Lydia. I could expect her to reproach me in my dreams, although maybe not. Knowing her, I was pretty sure she'd be happy for the simple fact that I was actually in some kind of relationship. It didn't matter who it was with. It didn't even have to be with a human being. It could be a crocodile. We were deposited a safe distance from the house, not far from the park. There, we traveled the rest of the way on foot. Thankfully, it was no longer raining. The car, meanwhile, with new license plates now, soundlessly melted into the darkness as if it had never existed. Still, we couldn't let up on our guard just yet. A key moment was approaching. Namely, how to make it up to the apartment without being detected. Elvira's sinister pastimes had provided her with the skills to make this possible. She could access the fire escape with a duplicate E-key she'd obtained from a security guard. What he'd gotten from her in return for this favor, well, better not to ask. The master key was just what we needed right now, though. There were some 3 emergency exits in the good-sized building. Normally, they were closed off with shock-proof doors. Any security officer could access them using a pass, but the residents had to use the front door, or gain entry through the underground parking, which required an E-key and also a reading of an implant. Each time someone entered the building, this was automatically noted in the security database. This type of thing was designed for folks like us. However, exits from the building were not logged in the database because both of us had left through the back parking lot, avoiding the scanners at the entrance. Ellie left that way all of the time, while I simply wanted to avoid the security guards, who, I assume, suspected me of being some kind of pedophile. If not for this kind of thing, we could have grabbed a gun from the cache and put Ellie's mommy dearest down, and then leave the city in the rearview mirror and never come back. We used the E key to open the heavy panels over the emergency entrance and found ourselves in a semi-dark stairwell. The lighting wasn't great here, so we had to grope our way up the stairs. Elvira, fortunately, used these stairs all the time, so she was my guide. A standard surveillance camera was stationed at the exit onto the landing, but we easily took it offline using a compact jammer that fit in a pocket. Too bad, since it could be seen that it had gone down, but it would have to suffice. Anyway, who really paid that kind of attention to these things? We entered Ellie's apartment and practically collapsed in each other's arms. Kind of like a couple of lovebirds, ignoring the cloud of holographic butterflies that immediately surrounded us. My legs simply cramped up and gave way. According to the time, we had 3 minutes left before the start. We were exhausted, of course, but all we could do was down a few light energy drinks from the fridge and get ready to upload. Ellie helped me out of my wet coat and stashed it somewhere. She wasn't in any hurry to head for her room, though, and hovered around my capsule as if she wanted to ask me something. "I'm not going to strip down for you," I said, reclining on the loading platform. "So what is it? Do you want me to tell you we did the right thing? I can't tell you one way or the other, that's for sure. As far as the authorities are concerned, you and I are criminals who belong behind bars. But we had no other way out. That's just logic. It was you or her."
"I know. I understand," Ellie said, head bowed. "It's just, why did she say that I wasn't her daughter?"
"Say what?" I asked, sitting up from surprise. "She said a lot of crazy stuff at the end. Why does that bother you so much? She called you a prostitute, for example, and a crazy psychopath."
"I know.
She was just trying to defend herself," I said dismissively. "It helped her to see you as a foundling, like Julia, 2 outsiders who threatened her children from her 2nd marriage. Don't overthink it." "I took 1 look at Julia and saw that you were sisters. No need for a DNA test." And I clumsily ran my forefinger down her Rasokina nose, lightly tapping the end of it. "Your daddy's little girl. He'd be proud of you. Of course, he should have been firmer with you, but anyway." Ellie smiled then, and the look of doubt on her face vanished. "Don't pay any attention to that nonsense at the end," I said, winding up my little lecture on family matters. "Think of that as another order, by the way."
"Yes, sir, Commander," she said,
giving me a little half-salute, and then she rushed up the stairs, discarding her clothing along the way. What a child. I shook my head and gave the order to upload. If only I could solve all problems in a single night with just a hacksaw and some resourcefulness, like back in good old 2007. Although, yes, in that case, I wouldn't be unfrozen now. Chapter 47, continued from Book 2. Everything was just as we left it back at the wheelhouse. Diad Fluch, otherwise known as Diana, was still at the helm. She was looking sexy, but rather bored in her tight jumpsuit,
as she tested system readiness before we exited into regular space. Our dusky beauty from the Mediterranean basin had also recently returned to the game, sending her stand-in off to catch some rest. Now she was totally immersed in idleness. Another member of the crew also headed off to real life along with the co-pilot. This was a low-level warrior who shared the same shift. That wasn't a big loss for our crew. What made me uneasy was the fact I was going into battle without my faithful partner. Shandine had taken family time off via a voice message in which she expressed great frustration. My Amazon was dying to fight, but one of her kids had fallen ill, and so that was that. I assured her that there were many battles to come, and she'd always be able to add frags to her collection. Of course, she was crazy with longing just the same. And so by the time we exited subspace, we only had 11 crew members on board. 3 engineers, Sven, the artilleryman, Macha, our medical expert, our pilot, Diana, and also 5 warriors. I'm a blademaster, myself, by the name of Cooldown. Ellie is my apprentice, who opted for the same rare specialty as mine. The reptilian defender by the name of Croc, his buddy, a foot soldier named Happenstance, and Creeman, a shooter. A human, according to his passport, he was, in fact, a GMO, a genetically modified human being. People who owned costly premium accounts were allowed one such enhancement, but any others had to be earned through gameplay. Being a shooter, Creeman, who hailed from the border of Germany and Austria, had opted to improve his vision. Shandine, too, had undergone genetic modifications. Since she was a scout, she selected extra speed, which made her as fast as a fleet-footed Rollick. Players from other planets could also undergo genetic modification, but only up to 3 times. And depending on their race, some areas open to genetic tinkering were off-limits. Only human beings were able to transform into whatever they wanted. We were as malleable as a lump of clay under the hands of a sculptor. Yet again, this showed how adaptable we are as a species. Having assessed our readiness as a crew, I assigned everyone to their posts in the various compartments. Being essential personnel, the engineers were stationed in the engine, shield, and energy core. I put Macha in the central cargo compartment so that she could swiftly come to the rescue of anyone who didn't end up heading for rebirth right away. I put the artilleryman in charge of the laser beam, and divided the warriors between the second armory, which is where the missiles were housed, and the drone control center. Once the players were all in place, most of the Corvette's parameters immediately shot up from the usual 2.5% to 10%. Awesome! Your grandmother was ready now to incinerate the opposition. All I needed now was to sit down in the co-pilot seat and order combat readiness. Our long leap across the span of this sector was coming to an end. "Well, let's get out of this shithole, what say?" Diana said, flashing a Hollywood smile. "Bring on the tunes!" And she turned on some kind of alien rock music, just as we emerged into open space not far from the outpost. We found ourselves surrounded by multicolored flashes of lights and gun and missile fire, not to mention debris from starships engaged in battle, all to the thumping beat of a bass guitar. The monitor displaying tactical action blinked as if in shock, and then revealed ever more opponents. The battle station monitors were much faster, quickly displaying the list of defenders, including your grandmother. It seemed that there were less and less of the latter with every minute. There were 3 units of Union Border Guards, mostly represented by heavy frigates. Of them, there was only 1 currently in action. There were ships belonging to clan member players, and also allies, not far away. But I had no idea how many of them were ready to help in the defense. Most of the defenders were concentrated around Talvro 19, with a few units circling outside the zone under attack, which housed the outpost's defense systems. These consisted of either nimble reconnaissance cutters or heavily protected corvettes with thick hulls, not unlike our ship. While the attackers looked better than the now defunct St. Permadeath, they were comprised primarily of cutters and frigates in varying states of decrepitude. There were no more than 5 serious threats out there. You could count them on 1 hand, that is. Chief among them was a massive breakthrough cruiser.
It was just a copy, but it could still wipe out a slew of ships with a single salvo. Still, it didn't look like it was in any hurry to join the fray. There were also two long-endurance battle destroyers that were busier than their flagship. The opposition was falling apart, more due to the shape it was in than from our firepower, but they outnumbered us 10-1. With an advantage like that, they didn't need a strategic advantage. Their satellites simply swarmed us by rushing into battle to certain death, samurai style. They fell even before they had time to unload all their ammo, shooting off half of their load or so. As for our radius of combat operations, the ship's computer swiftly counted some 89 objects. Meanwhile, we were merely on the outskirts of this interstellar mess, which meant that the density of the enemy starships was only going to increase further on. I saw no reason to rush headlong into the thick of it, so I focused on the low-hanging fruit. I also activated broadcast mode. I had to stay in step with the times, right? That's why I made sure to capture everything on video. I wasn't about to go viral with this kind of thing. Space battles weren't anything new. I simply felt instinctively that a solid alibi wouldn't hurt. I'm talking about the fact that just about now, a fire would be breaking out in a certain hangar back in the real world. The counter immediately highlighted a couple of dozen spectators. I wondered what they were doing as they watched. Were they eating? On the road? Working? I could hardly believe how some people spent all their time sitting behind a screen. Lots of times, during long subspace jumps, there wasn't anything at all going on. I hoped we weren't going to be a disappointment to our small, better-than-nothing fan base. Meanwhile, I was about to see what I'd picked up by poring so long over space combat tutorials. Amway had provided most of them, but some of them I'd found on my own. I'd needed to work on some professional developed for some time now, because of my rather lackluster stats. But the huge sea of opponents out there suggested I wouldn't make much headway with them today. Most ships out there didn't seem to even notice our sudden appearance. It wasn't that they were ignoring us. It's just that they themselves were forced to be myopic too. And yet the ship's onboard computer issued a warning that an enemy scan had been initiated. Who was this curious assailant? Interestingly, two combat frigates and a corvette such as ours, and in no way our inferior, were probing us in an attempt to discern any vulnerabilities. The catalog suggested that the prototype for this ship was a fourth-generation unit from raw reptilian production. It was a solid ship indeed, and would be something we could use in our fleet. Sadly, though, this wasn't the best scenario for launching an assault party. "How about we break the ice by politely greeting them?" I said. "Fire the laser." Our annihilator immediately launched a beam of charged particles at the enemy starship. Wowza! It shone brighter than the local sputtering star. The pilot of the poor ship, whose shields weren't up to par anymore, only had time to say his last prayers. I did this for him. "Amen to you, buddy. Take a bow." The blast hit the reactor compartment head-on, and the ship didn't stand a chance. It swelled up like a fiery balloon, in the process reducing the capacity of the three satellite ships to zero, and seriously lowered the charge in a dozen or so other ships. This was our ultimate weapon, so yeah, you can't argue with that. The drawback was that it was out for the next 10 minutes. And it could be worse if we didn't have an artilleryman in the weapon compartment and an engineer next to the core. In that case, the beam would take even longer to reload. Probably we'd be able to use it before the battle was over, and that's about it. Now we could turn to easier targets. Our conventional missiles would suffice. They were slow to reach the target, and were thus rather archaic in the era of interstellar travel. But they shouldn't be underestimated in terms of their deadliness. First, they have great homing systems, which makes them highly accurate. And secondly, energy shields aren't effective against them because they hit a wide section of the hull. We were able to create a far more explosive material for them once the station's weapon module had been upgraded. Now, with just 2 or 3 successful hits, we could destroy any of the enemy's cutters. That being said, I didn't use up our extremely limited ammunition exclusively on destroying enemy units. What I did was aim each missile from the first cassette at a dedicated target, namely the weapon bays of enemy ships. The smaller starships each had a single weapon bay, you see. Our volley of missiles knocked out 6 of them at once. Only one of them held hard and fast. 2 shells couldn't put it out of action. Just the same, we managed to knock their modules into the red zone, greatly reducing their ability to strike back. And so these ships were out of the picture for quite a while, and posed no threat to us until their crews put the pieces back together again. I wasn't going to let that happen, though, and so I sent a squad of combat drones their way, armed with simple laser guns. Why not hit them while they're down and out? The laser guns were all that we could afford given our budget, but they'd suffice, even though they weren't lethal. Kremen and Ellie, being the youngest, most ardent crew members, handled the rather mundane drones. It was okay if they screwed up, because these drones were put together right here in the Corvette from scrap metal and commonly found minerals, really prosaic stuff. And moreover, despite her feigned indifference, Diana was quite industrious and had assembled 3 entire drone squads en route to Pandora and back. Good for her, but nevertheless, pretty soon I'd have to take a close look at our fearless pilot. Yes, she'd truly fallen into a hairy situation not long ago, but lots of her apparent bruises and wounds didn't line up with what you'd expect from a normal brawl. I'd suspected our sultry beauty with the throaty voice had her own game going on, and now I was sure of it. All that I need now was to find out if she was working on our side or on behalf of someone else. Meanwhile, our nimble laser-equipped drones did their work on the damaged chips in the space of a minute, about the time it took to reload a new cartridge packed with missiles. By then, 2 more or less solid-looking frigates finished scanning us and commenced to open fire. The closest one trained a quad of rapid-fire cannons on your grandmother, pelting us with cheap kinetic projectiles. It was like shooting an elephant with a BB gun. Well, that's what they had, then. Good for taking out, say, lightly armored targets, like cutters, satellites, or drones. The other frigate, however, used rather powerful laser weapons that alternately hit us at the same spot. Our shield held strong, but its capacity dropped by 30%. Our body also suffered damage, although not much. What sucked, though, is that other adversaries decided to jump into the fray. Some were shelling us, while others were trying to take out our drones. We couldn't count on regenerating our charge now, because whatever we gained was taken out by a hit. Diana snapped to action then, and started making a series of tight turns, so that we weren't such an easy target. This seemed to work for the small fry targeting us, but then other players in the siege started to drift into the action around us. I fired the next missiles in our arsenal at the frigate armed with lasers, and finally knocked out one installation. This helped, but we seriously lacked support and needed some kind of cover in order to recharge. As if reading my mind, just then our talented clan leader got in touch. "Greetings, streamer! Better late than never!" We got here as fast as we could, but had to take some risky shortcuts through unexplored spaces where no man has gone before. "Good thinking. Otherwise, you'd have run into some of our leftovers out there. As you see, we're being pounded out here without so much as a may I please? No attempt at fun and games." I identified the ill-fated frigate among the rest of the defenders and entered it on the register of priority allies. It was long, like a spear, and looked like a giant canoe floating in space. This was one of the most common Orthorian designs, 5th range. It wasn't noted for its weaponry, but it had a worthy power plant that provided it with an excellent shield. It must be on our port side. But what was really strange is that the system showed that Bumtastic wasn't on board the ship, which was the Flujigemon, rather. He was at the outpost. "So why aren't you on the front line?" I asked, surprised. "You won't believe it, but the station admins suggested I lead a cell of local militiamen, comprised of players and NPCs stuck down here." "What the hell? What can you do from down there to help us?" "Well, nobody expects us to stop the freaks given the state of our forces," replied Bumtastic cheerfully. "Lots of our guys fled as soon as they saw the number of opponents headed our way.
The system freaks were tanking on purpose, but they were intercepted just before the jump. Not many of them succeeded in leaving. So we came here for nothing? I frowned. It wasn't like we could simply exit this scene, that's for sure. So what the fuck were we doing here? Don't freak out. The Union promised to compensate everyone for the costs. Fully. So wait, you mean they'll replace all of the lost ships? Absolutely. Fully loaded, he replied. So man up and pick off as many assholes as you can before the cavalry rides in. If we make a good show of it, you might be able to write off your ill-gotten debts, and that includes any outstanding loans. I was so blown away by this news that I almost missed the rocket system's latest cooldown. It no longer made sense to attack a slew of opponents, so I directed all of our firepower at the battered frigate, practically ripping apart its hull. The ship tried to limp to the rear, but en route, it ran smack into a shard of tracer wreckage that pierced it clean through. That was that. Another one bites the dust. How long should we kill time out here? I asked, as I selected new targets from among the biggest threats. 6 hours, no less, the clan leader said. But you're not likely to make it that far, since their flagship and its retinue will roll over everybody before then. The only way to hold them back is to stop them at the station itself. That's what I'm working on here. What this meant was that there was no way to avoid the storming of the outpost. It's not likely that the satellites would even attempt to capture a colossus like that. Instead, they'd simply try to blow it up by destabilizing one of the reactors. Unless they had a powerful portable bomb, which, given where they were at, technologically speaking, wasn't likely. Sculptors were advanced only in the field of genetics, and that was about it. A ship's core can't easily be dismantled, much less transported deep into a station. Even if they arranged for a ship the size, say, of our corvette, to explode right at the docks, that wouldn't be enough to sink the station. And that's why an invasion is where the final stand would be. And damn, it was going to be apocalyptic. I won't be about to bust my way through to you, I said. But I'll distract as many of them as I can. Okay, hang on, my man, Bumtastic said. The homeland will not forget you. And then he signed off. I took a quick glance at the broadcast numbers, just to see if we'd lost any viewers, and to my surprise, I saw that we now surpassed 100 spectators. I guess people loved looking at the underdog. That's the only way I could explain it. I already suspected that we were going to have a hell of a time repelling even one wave of attackers. But now, after gaining an understanding of the actual balance of power, I was convinced of it. But at least now I no longer had to worry about what we'd have to pay to insurance to get the starships up and running again, not to mention what it would take to level them up again. That would send us into out-and-out bankruptcy. All right, then. We didn't have to worry about that. Great. Let's do it. 4 other damaged cutters were hastily retracting their nozzles and dashing off, but our speedy little drones caught up with them. Our score was slowly inched up, but fresh enemy forces took the place of their fallen comrades faster than we could deal with them. Our shield was down 50%, and that was with 3 red-blooded engineers and several repair droids. Within 9 minutes, we managed to decimate some 4 dozen vessels of varying hues, and we damaged far more than that. We were almost finished recharging the laser yet again, while I selected the next victim, when they decided to take us seriously. 12 frigates, led by 2 corvettes, came to the aid of their small fry brethren. The first corvette looked totally man-made in its design, resembling a shuttle from a 1980s-era comic book, but the second, yikes! It was long and cylindrical, save for an open end, like the mouth of a tunnel. It looked like a mid-sized cutter could fly into the ship through that hole without touching the walls. The starship busted into our battlefield and braked, and then a cold glow lit it up from within, seeping out of the vessel's orifices. The other ships drew near each other and circled around Yo Grandmother. Battling a sinking feeling in my stomach, I referred to the catalog and was dumbfounded. This was Sutaka Ka, a 7th range replica of an elite artillery corvette. It had our number. The angular design, along with the name, betrayed its Azerhaden registration. The name was obscene in Russian, and so in our gaming environment, it was given the nickname Rusprayer to get around the censors. Sometimes people called them shitpipes, although this was the name applied to the entire category of these types of ships. This was, in fact, a giant plasma cannon fueled by several reactors. It could shoot beams of matter in gaseous states. Most of the time, metal was used, and it was launched by an electromagnetic particle accelerator. This projectile was a lot like a cumulative jet that incinerated everything in its path. The magnitude of the charge fired by the Rusprayer was so great that any shield less than that of a destroyer was useless, even if it was totally intact. Fortunately, though, this weapon did have some disadvantages, namely a rather slow flight speed, at least compared to a laser, something like a quarter of the speed of light. Also, its range wasn't the greatest. Plasma would dissipate in space and lose power. Its big-ass plasma gun was the only advantage of the Corvette. Its cocoon could withstand the impact only of small asteroids and small-caliber shelling. It didn't have any other weapons due to the numerous reactors, which could barely manage to handle the energy needs of the particle reactors, to the detriment of the engines and other systems. Thus, it wasn't very fast, nor was it strong when it came to maneuverability. Even cargo shuttles could run circles around it. Thus, unless it had satellites to provide cover for it, the Rusprayer was an open target on its own. As with any self-propelled artillery, actually. "That's a ship that deserves to be called a Flujajimin," I muttered, as I frantically looked for a way out of this one. They were definitely trying to do us in now. Obviously. Now that they knew they had us, the enemy shiplings all trained their barrels on us, dropping our shield into the red zone. We suffered over 24 hits, but at least they were on different modules. The production bay, hold, and warp mesh module were severely damaged. Cool. At least they were all expendable. We could smell things frying, though. Even though they weren't able to destroy our frigate in one fell swoop, they did their damage, and we had less room to maneuver now. And they were then joined by other cutters that weren't yet knocked out of commission. These, too, wanted to take part in our demolition. We fought back, but without much success. The shots lobbed at us increasingly hit us in the engine compartments, reducing their performance. Clearly, they were aiming to cut us off at the knees so that we couldn't simply slip out of the way of the red-hot plasma blast that was to ensue once the Rusprayer had accumulated a sufficient charge. Of course, we might be able to blast them first with our laser beam, but that didn't mean much. Even if we did manage to penetrate the fully intact shield of the artillery corvette and disable it, we still had a swarm of other vessels targeting us now. What they lacked in integrity was more than made up for in quantity. We had to somehow slam the door in their faces, but how, with no cover whatsoever? The single frigate on our side, circling nearby, fled as soon as it comprehended what we were up against. In fact, we'd succeeded in drawing so many enemy forces into the attack on us that for a couple of minutes, our side suffered no losses at all. And so, at least for a while, we'd postponed the enemy's landing on the station. The battleships that approached the outpost, which were, in fact, the sculptor's main striking force besides their flagship, were contained thus far by our joint efforts. Right now, the cruiser was stationed in back of their forces, serving as a support platform, a counterbalance to our Union station. If not for this, the losses among the regular satellite starships would be colossal. By the way, speaking of airborne assaults, we had on board right now several warriors who were raring to fight, instead of sitting out the entire battle hunkered behind gear. Maybe this was the time to bust some alien butt. "Diana, you're in charge." I'd thrown all of my development points into my skills wielding a blade, and had attained the much-desired 75 points required for the leaf-shaped Azerhaden sword. I'd had it stashed in inventory since our fun times on Shibukai, since I had no use for it until now. I rose to my feet, and with relish summoned it from subspace. I loved the weight of it now in my hands.
I swooshed it around a couple of times, almost amputating the arm off my chair, at which point I headed out of the cramped wheelhouse. I had no reason to be there anymore.
"Where are you off to?"
asked Diana, alarmed, looking up from the displays. "I'm going to round some warriors up. As soon as you can, aim the laser beam at the corvette. Meanwhile, train all the missiles on its shield. Do your best to drain it. And don't forget about drones. Throw everything you have at it."
"Are you planning on making landing on an enemy ship?" she asked. "Which one?"
"On that beauty." I pointed at an image of Rasprayer on a display. Diana looked at it and gave a low whistle.
"Are you sure you know what you're doing? That's a monster."
"Don't be too impressed," I said reassuringly. "It doesn't even have a troop compartment. Let's just see if I can get to it without an incident."
"As if," she smiled sarcastically, and nodded at the line of ships in front of the artillery corvette. "They'll all be thrilled to spot you on their radar."
"You'll have to distract them," I said as I exited. "Wasn't there a reason why we churned out all those dummies?" Before I'd checked out to real life, she and I had discussed various strategies for this battle, including my landing on an enemy ship. The only problem with using a boarding team is that the departure of personnel from our ship would easily be detected by enemy scans, and any high-precision laser weapon could then shoot us down en route. Thus, the normal procedure was to first suppress the defense systems before trying to board an enemy ship. Unfortunately, we didn't have this option. Although the artillery corvette lacked the ability to defend itself from outside invasion, the many light reconnaissance craft circling around it like flies over a cow pie made self-defense unnecessary. Such vessels were often called mosquitoes. No wonder. As much as we wanted, we couldn't kill off all of them. By the time that happened, the frigates would be picking over the remains of your grandmother without any need for the plasma gun. They had too big of an advantage in terms of weaponry, even if these weren't the most powerful guns. Our only way to slip through this formation was to use false targets to distract the mosquitoes. Which is why, long before I summoned the troops, so to speak, we started shooting a slew of dummies out of the troop compartment, comprised of the cheapest crapola from our ship's holds. They looked like real paratroopers on the enemy's scanners, until we activated their jetpacks. However, the Rasprayer was located some 150,000 kilometers away. That was farther than some used cars could make it without breaking down. But we couldn't get any closer than that due to the enemy ships at our back. Diana did her best to maneuver us to a better drop-off point, but without much success. We felt hits landing on Yo Grandmother, and the air was saturated with the smell of burnt metal. Our lights were dimmed now, and we had to use a neural interface for illumination. Just the same, I found myself stopping in at the living quarters and pausing by Shandine's capsule. She looked so peaceful in her cocoon. Her well-endowed bosom was rising and falling as she slumbered. Her lips were slightly parted, and her eyelids were fluttering as if she was about to awaken. I fought the urge to linger. She looked so defenseless, even though I knew that this was just an empty shell, and that her soul was far away, and she was, in fact, perfectly safe. I couldn't stop myself from tucking back a blonde, unruly curl, and squaring my shoulders, I gripped my curved sword and strode away. Most of all, I wanted to kick some butt. My current partner, Ellie, caught up with me at the landing module. She was attired in light armor and had a titanium capesh strapped to her back. She had barely attained level 20, and so this was the best blade she could wield right now. And it wasn't a bad weapon for her, with its crescent blade and reptilian design. It provided both durability and the capacity to do real damage. At one time, I relied on a capesh myself, and destroyed plenty of droids with it, not to mention regular adversaries and armor. The launcher had just fired off another batch of dummies, making room for us in the airlock chambers, which resembled torpedo compartments. Ellie and I each crawled into one of them at the edges, while the rotund robotic loaders pack fresh explosives in. We were pairing up rather than moving in as a team to increase our chances of making it to the artillery corvette. Thus, The others were lined up to follow us as we prepared to leave. And we launched. I felt pressure on my chest as we accelerated into the interstellar void, zipping past the bright flashes of the raging battle. I could hear Ellie's ecstatic little scream right behind me. What a child. Now a child flying in space. Her arms spread wide. She sped toward Rasprayer, as if oblivious to the fact that she could go down at any moment. We were, of course, wearing protective suits, and an energy shell stopped us from being sucked into the cosmic vacuum. But should we cross paths with, say, space debris, that would be the end of us. And yes, there was plenty of rubbish floating around out here. Someday, vultures who picked over major battle sites would have a field day here. You could estimate how long it would be before a mass of players, and others even, headed over here in search of riches. Assuming, of course, that we succeeded in repelling the attack on the outpost of the Union of Anthropomorphs. If we didn't, this sector of space would no longer exist. Nothing would stop the sculptors from placing reinforcements here. One thing's for sure, and that is that Talvro 19 was no longer a quiet, peaceful oasis in a remote corner of the galaxy. Chapter 48. They trained lasers at us from all sides, but the dummies we'd released did the trick, despite the numbers of enemy ships firing at us. We were lost in the throng, as it were. A dummy would explode near us now and then. But so far, we weren't hit. And in the meantime, Diana stirred things up by sending out another rocket salvo that hit the enemy corvette, forcing it to retreat behind the cover of its smaller shiplings. Our last drones descended on these. They didn't do any serious damage, but they drew fire. A minute after Ellie and I pushed off, the other two followed us, also under the cover of a swarm of dummies. There wasn't much I could do in the meanwhile, so I decided to seize the opportunity to take a look at the neural interface. Wow, our viewership was now up to 1,500, and was growing steadily. Apparently, boarding an enemy ship whilst under heavy fire isn't a common endeavor, much less when your home ship is slated to be blown apart in a matter of minutes. Despite this, Diana was having a rollicking good time. Happy as a clam, Elvira and I were about a third of the way to our destination when the pilot fired the LFZ at the enemy corvette. From our vantage point in the cosmos, it was stunning. For a brief moment, a bright stream of light formed a bridge between the two starships that was nothing less than ethereal. Then the sculptor's ship morphed into a compact little sun before dissipating into a neon cloud of hot gas. Apparently, the reactors, which had been hit the hardest, had exploded. This, in turn, resulted in a wave of red-hot fragments, each one shining brighter than the next, that then flew like shrapnel into the neighboring frigates, one of which continued its trajectory as a lifeless hunk of metal controlled by no one at all. Chalk up one corvette in our favor, along with several smaller vessels. At this, our viewership tripled. But we didn't get to celebrate this little victory for long. The massive plasma gun had finally charged up and released a bright white blob with an impressive contrail at your grandmother. Although we weren't anywhere nearby, my shield was nearly knocked off by the G-load. Diana was drawing near the gunner with the aim of descending on it, and in so doing, she'd signed her own death warrant. She managed to lead the axe-shaped corvette out of the main line of fire, but merely by brushing the shining blob, a deep groove was seared along the entire hull that burned through the armor. Our warship was toast already. But this didn't stop the remaining enemy frigates from lobbing several volleys at it, transforming our clan's pride and joy into a worthless wreck. The icons depicting our allies in the interface were all gray now, and we were alone. Meanwhile, the cursed destroyer, with its nozzles maliciously winking, was now lazily rotating. It wasn't hard to guess where it was heading. Back to the front line, of course. The starship was equal to a destroyer in terms of firepower, so by returning to service, it would shift the balance of power firmly on the side of the sculptors. "Let's move it, guys. Full power," I said, activating my jetpack. We had no reason to hide anymore.
Either we'd catch up with the clumsy artillery corvette, or we'd end up dangling in space until our energy cells were used up, unless someone shot us first. My vision of what we were about out here required a lot more speed, period. Even at max velocity, we moved ludicrously slowly. The good thing was that the enemy ships had been too distracted by their need to protect the pseudo-terrestrial corvette, and it was only with an effort that they managed to come to their senses. The shots at us continued, but they were random and all over the place. It was like their guidance systems were destabilized or something. Our biggest threat was right before us. We had to slow down fast as we approached the gunner, lest we be smashed against the hull like a bug on a windshield. Alternatively, we could be burned like a moth in a flame if its protective field treated us like minor asteroids. We got a host of hints from the neural interface, and this helped us out. Moreover, the Rasprayer's massive silhouette was broader than that of a standard ship, so it was hard to miss. And so it wasn't long before I was safely adhered to its sides with my magnets, catching up with Ellie, who was already there, bumbling around the hull. She'd arrived much sooner than I had, and was looking for a convenient access point. A small hatch for repair work looked particularly promising. Apparently, it was for maintenance droids. Of course, it was locked, but we weren't looking for an invitation to board. I had my break-in kit. I connected my special electronic master key to the control panel and waited for the others. Happenstance and Crocot, inseparable as always, were next to arrive. Crocot almost killed himself due to his impressive mass. He wore heavy power armor that looked like something a medieval knight would sport, and had weapons up the yazoo on him, which made him weigh a ton. "Well, there," said Happenstance to his partner, pulling him closer and securing him to the hull with magnetic grips. "I think you broke your legs. Aren't you a new one? The commander can just cut them off with a sword, and you can just grow new ones, right?"
"Don't listen to this moron, boss," rasped Crocot. "I'd die out here if you did that."
"Don't worry," I said soothingly. "I don't do amputations, except tongues, if I must." Happenstance, his face deadpan serious, hid behind the laughing Ellie's back. Luckily, she was posing as a fully grown young woman in the game, even though alien. In real life, it would have taken at least two of her to shield a guy like him. The next arrival was Macha, always chipper, who immediately started fussing over Crocot. But she couldn't do much to treat his injuries unless he dropped his energy shield. Thus, only through self-regeneration could he be helped, which amused his friend. Crocot had a first aid kit built into his armored suit, and this numbed the pain in his limbs. But it wasn't enough to restore him to his former fighting shape. Macha, our medic and scientist, had been paired with Kremen, but he was taken out by anti-aircraft fire. Meanwhile, everyone else from Yo Grandmother was also now in, well, the other world. Altogether, our small group, though few in number, was what you'd want in a boarding party. We were as angry as a nest of hornets and thirsty for revenge. Thus, once the narrow airlock was open, we all crammed into it, including the medic and injured defender. Nobody wanted to be left under the cold starlight. We spilled out into a technical corridor entwined with cables and other communications gear, looking like five desperate pirates. There were also some spider-like maintenance robots, all deactivated, located there. Macha immediately set about getting Crocot out of enough of his armor to let her tend to his injuries, while my young Padawan and I began to carry out some reconnaissance. We could really use Shandine and her inconspicuous bloodhound drones right now, but they only heeded their mistress. They were part of her gear. We used the master key again when we reached the bulkhead separating us from the ship's interior. It was a drag waiting for the key to work, but there weren't any hackers around who could unlock the door more quickly. We had to work with what we had. As the master key did its thing, we imbibed some stimulants by rubbing them on her brows, thereby enhancing our characteristics a bit. And we marveled at how our viewers were now actively betting on whether or not we'd succeed in capturing the corvette. Most thought it was a long shot due to how small our party of paratroopers was. I had 10,000 credits to spare, and so partially out of nothing else to do right then, I threw it into the pot. After all, we weren't in danger of financial ruin anymore.
Before the doors were opened, our reptilian fighter was ready to don his armor again. But we didn't let our clumsy hulk lead the way, although he wielded a powerful cannon with the promising name Wallbreaker. Swordsmen also do well on the front lines, and moreover, if we ended up suffering in terms of health, we could rest up behind Krokot's broad back. Beyond the bulkhead lay a new passageway, which was much wider and vaster. There were rectangular arches with hermetic seals installed in the passageway every 10 meters. Fortunately, they weren't shut at present. I referred to the schematic and estimated our location. Then I determined the shortest pathway to the corvette's wheelhouse. We couldn't afford to systematically ransack every corner of the ship, after all. We'd butt horns with whoever crossed our path. And, yes, I meant it when it came to the horns. The three beasties heading our way had a medley of them. They'd be a novelty in any zoo. I guess if I wanted to use a pithy word for these guys, I'd call them chimeras. They were like a parody of what an alien was with their twisted bodies covered in horny plates, some of them like spikes, some of which were covered in quite ordinary-looking skin. It was like someone had randomly patched together the biological parts of various creatures and organisms with no regard to symmetry or functionality. Because their limbs were mismatched, they sort of moved like woodlice, curling up in a revolting ball and then unfurling to propel themselves forward. They reminded me of the old Dominion, except that the latter was by far more menacing and even more disgusting. I wouldn't be surprised if the sculptors had taken from the Dominions enough traits to produce cheap these things to serve as cannon fodder. In that event, we should start calling them the plagiarists. These guys had organic weapons, horns, spikes, and limbs, and they also clutched fully functional firearms and shotguns. Moreover, they had a lot of them, what with having several paws, it seems. They wore simple harnesses, home-produced, it looked like. As soon as these centipedes stood erect, they fired indiscriminately, covering the floor in shell casings. They also screamed like bloodthirsty gulls hopelessly sick with tuberculosis. Good God! Too bad they weren't designed to be mute. Ellie and I immediately activated our portable shields and moved in close to each other. Sparks flew about from the ricocheting bullets. These were ordinary kinetic projectiles, no bells and whistles, and we could easily deflect them. None of the three freaky beasties exceeded level 40, so they didn't pose a serious threat. Except for, say, the girls, maybe, if they were up against them by themselves. We doubled up and hacked apart the first genetic mistake, who was wielding two rifles and a submachine gun. I had to hold back, actually, so that my student could inflict more damage and do him in once and for all. Krokot was at our back in the middle of the passageway, occasionally firing something loud out of his hand cannon. Meanwhile, the others prudently ducked behind the protruding bulkhead wings. But these creepy crawlies weren't as helpless in close combat as they were in firefights. They didn't fit into a category as such, but I would call them melee men, and I had to constantly swivel around to avoid hitting what felt like mush, and one of them whipped a flexible tentacle at me that left me a little stunned. My life dropped 10%, but Ellie set about hacking at the insidious limb. She was fluttering around the two centipedes like a vicious little wasp. It was her gymnastic training, enhanced by her Relekian racial boost, coming into play. I let her go at it, especially since the others were now firing at the mutants, meaning the fight wasn't about to drag on. And in another minute or two, the girl, though out of breath, screamed in victory as she hoisted up the crushed head of one of the slain opponents. This battle gave her an upgrade of 2 levels at once, and all of our group shared the experience points. As far as I was concerned, it was all good. This was the best that the satellites could offer us, I guess. The firearms we scored, well, they were all of the same crappy quality as most of the stuff their creators produced. We couldn't use any of it, including the homemade harnesses.
"What an abomination," said Happenstance, kicking one of the centipedes. "Before this, I thought that head up your ass was just a figure of speech."
"I guess you'd know that one, right?" asked Elvira with a smirk.
"No, nor do I want to."
"How many of these fuck faces are there?" asked Krokot.
"I doubt if there are many of them," I shrugged. "Statewide, there can't be more than 33 humanoids on board a vessel.
The minimum is 10. But how can you classify these things as organisms?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.